chapter 6.
Where's Genesis?
Build a rocket ship.
build a boat. Not just a boat, but a big boat. The largest structure up to that point that had ever been. And we looked at this a while back, and hopefully I'm going to draw some things out here that after looking at it some more that I didn't notice before, and hopefully you have. And I pointed this out before in the past, but I measured 450 feet from the front of the steps here. You go all the way down the street here till you get to the pass on the corner where the Methodist Church is, the stop sign. That's 450 feet. That's how long the ark would have been. So when you leave today, you go out the front door and you look down there, and you can get an idea of how long the ark was. 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, 45 feet high. God says, the flood's coming. Do me a favor, don't build a boat. Not just a houseboat for you and your family, but a large, hugest structure ever built up to that point. And notice what Noah says there in verse 22 of chapter 6. He says, Thus Noah did according to all that God commanded him, so he did. So there's no question, there's no but God, but Lord. That's a huge task. I don't know if I can do it. It just simply says, Noah did according to all that God commanded him, and so he did. No questions asked. Why was that? Well, go back to verse 9. Because it says, this is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generation. Notice what it says. Noah what? Walked with God. That meant before he was asked to build this ark, he walked with God. While he was building the ark, he was walking with God, and he would be walking with God. And the reason for that is because if you look back in the chapter before that, it says that his great-grandfather walked with God, his grandfather walked with God, and we assume Lamech, who is his father, walked with God also. So let me just, this is a side note from my message. It's very important that your kids see you walk with God. Because if they don't, chances are down the road, they're not going to walk with God. That's free. It's not extra. Building the ark was not a weekend project. And sometimes we look at it and we see the little cardboard cutout pictures and stuff and flannel boards and we see a nice little neat little story in the package and we forget the Bible. That's a whole other sermon. That's a whole other message on how the days of Noah were. But it wasn't a weekend task. Think about this. I didn't really think about it, break it down like this, but think about it. There was no lumberjacks around to help. I read one commentator that said it's safe to assume that Noah had hired help to build the ark. No, it's not. He didn't ask Noah to get help. Maybe he did, but the assumption is, no, he did it himself. There was no lumberjacks that would help him. Why would a wicked generation who was filled with violence and sexual immorality and murder at the drop of a hat want to help Noah, this crazy man? Think about it. No lumberjacks, no chainsaws, no power tools, no tractors, no sawmill, no boatyards, no ratch hardware. Hello? No cranes to hoist the logs. I mean, think about it, 45 feet in the air, you've got logs being hoisted. No construction crew, no rock monsters like the movie portrays. And think about this. When you picture Noah building the ark, we think, who would help him? His family, right? He's got 8 people, he's got his 3 sons and their wives, and Noah's wife, 8 of them made it into the ark, and they were saved by the ark. God saved him through the ark. My mind, your mommy's picturing his boys helping him, right? And they probably did. Something I learned new, duh. When you start looking at timelines and things like that, God asked Noah to build this ark 20 years before his sons were born. So think about this. For at least 30 years, probably, before his sons were able to help him, he was building that sucker by himself. Maybe his wife helped, we don't know. Maybe his father helped, we don't know for sure. But that's a huge, huge task. God told Noah, you know, it hasn't has Brandon, he tells him to build an ark. Noah's life was no longer his, guys. No, it didn't belong to him anymore. Noah's calendar wasn't his calendar anymore. I was thinking about this. It was a full-time job. The command to build the ark was a daily task. It was chopping and cutting and hauling and hewing and sawing and hoisting and hammering and painting pitch. You wake up the next morning, put ice and top on, and do it all over again. Can you imagine the hard work that it took to do that? I mean, he's probably working with some urgency here. I've got to save my family and preach to this generation and try to get them to get on board and repent. There's some urgency here, and he's probably working night and day to get this thing done and accomplished. And can you imagine the sore muscles and the blisters and all of that that went into it? Because of this pretty picture we've been painted in Sunday school, we missed the faith that it took for him to do that. 120 years. And he didn't quit. So many times we want maturity in Christ to come through a drive-through window. If we could just mature our faith, you know, just going through a drive-through window, that would be awesome. You know, just quit, grow and mature. But for some of us, that would be take too long. If we were honest with us. But he didn't quit. That's faith. And it doesn't tell us anywhere that God gave Noah some supernatural strength or ability. Doesn't say that the animals helped him, like some movies portray. You know, the monkeys coming and giving him wood and stuff like that. Just says Noah built the ark. That's faith. And you better believe the world noticed. You think they didn't notice a 450-foot long boat? It probably became a landmark, I'd say. You know how you give people directions? Somebody say, "Hey, Bob, where do you live?" "Well, go to the ark and take a left." You're not going to miss that, right? You better believe that every single piece of wood that was hammered into that, every time they heard the hammer go, it was a reminder of Noah preaching to them, repent. Noah was all in, guys. That's a picture of the Christian life. All or nothing. My calendar doesn't belong to me anymore. Your calendar doesn't belong to me anymore. Wherever he wants you to, we sing a lot of great songs up here. "Where you lead me, I'll follow," but do we really get it? That's tough. He was all in. Listen, faith rarely is comfortable. Faith is rarely convenient or easy. Rarely is it. Imagine building this ark with a world that was full, and surrounded by people who were full of evil only continually. That every intent of their heart was full of evil and violence. Can you imagine building in that environment? How much faith would that take? How many of us would truly stand, like our theme says, if surrounded, but it was just us in the world? I mean, there's estimates that it could be up to 1 billion people at that time. People lived for, Methuselah died at 969 years old. Population, you're 1 in 1 billion? The wickedness, with the people being that wicked, you can only imagine they were asking themselves, who is this God that Noah refers to? Who is Noah to tell us, to tell the future, or to condemn other people? Who is this guy? Who's this self-righteous guy? To claim that his God is the only way to salvation through this boat that's never been framed before. You better believe Noah stood alone. We have to imagine they mocked him something horrible. You think that people mocked you because of your faith? Imagine Noah. He didn't have probably a big support group to go to, other than maybe his wife. And I doubt Noah was the kind of guy, because he walked with God, I doubt Noah was the kind of guy that went and cried to his wife a lot. "I'm going to make your foot open. They're calling me crazy." You wonder, with a world full of violence, did they physically attack him? I believe so. Did families do a drive-by gawking? Probably. There they are, son. Look at Noah. It's a nut job. Did he have times of doubt? You better believe I'm sure he did. Peter did. John the Baptist did. David did. I'm sure Noah did. But for 120 years, he worked and he worked and he labored and he labored. Why? Because he came from a line of people who walked with God. 120 years. Let me just throw this out here. You can't fake an ark. I want you to think about that statement. I've been reading a book on As in the Days of Noah, and that's one of the things he pointed out there, was you can't fake an ark. I thought, wow, that's profound. You can up to a point. Noah could have faked building an ark. He could have gathered a bunch of stuff and said, hey, everybody repent, because it's going to flood. I'm building a big boat. And never finished it. But people are going to notice that. It's the same way in our Christian life. We can fake being a Christian for so long, but pretty soon people are going to know it's not genuine. That's why I, as a pastor, I never pretend that I'm better than anybody else. Me and the sheep, we are on the same playing field. I have the same sinful desires sometimes that you have, right? I stumble just like you do. Noah's the same way. Peter was the same way. Paul said, why is it I find myself doing the things I know I shouldn't do? But you can't fake it. They're going to know if you're genuine or not. That's why I'm about as real as I can be with people, because I want you to understand, look, I'm not perfect. You're not perfect. But you can't fake faith. They're going to know. Jesus said you're going to know them by their fruit. Doesn't mean you're fruit inspectors, guys. You don't go inspecting fruit, right? But you're going to know them by their fruit. It's going to be visible. Jesus said this is how they'll know you're my disciples, that you have love for one another. You can tell, right? So, I'm reading this book. We're on vacation. We're on the way home. We have a 13-hour drive. We get 3.5 hours away from home. Shanda, I just want to go home. Shanda's like, let's stop and we'll eat. I'm like, oh, we're going to have to go in. Let's just go through the drive-thru. We only got 3.5 hours left. No, well, a light had come on. It was driving a little weird. So we decided to pull off. She's taking the kids. I'm like, I'm not going to eat. I'm going to check out and see what's going on. I look under the car and there's transmission fluid just running out of the bottom of this thing. Now, I am mechanically challenged. If you know me, you know that to be true. But I do know what transmission fluid looks like. I do know what oil looks like. And I know what water looks like. And that was transmission fluid. And it was like, it would pour and then it would stop. And then it would pour and then it would stop. I mean, it was just like, oh, and it just kept going. We could feel. So Shanda's walking into the restaurant, and I'm like, Shanda! Now, let me back up just a little bit, because this is important to the story. I'm reading this book on Noah, and I am very convicted about my faith and lack thereof compared to Noah. And I almost wrote on a faith book, I am making the declaration I'm going to live by faith more, and blah, 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 and I didn't do that, I'm glad I didn't. I'm going to tell you something right now. I failed big time. Shannon's just like, matter of fact, like, it'll all work out. She's walking in. I'm like, Shannon! Come here. Do you see this? Samuel, you looked at her. You saw it. It was just pouring out. Shannon saw it. It's just, you call Jeff Baxter. Well, at first she said, call John. I called John, and I couldn't get him, and I called Jeff Baxter. Dad, they'll tell you what to do. We're going to go eat. Yeah.
And, inside, pretty angry in that situation.
They're walking in, so I'm like, okay. So I call, and Jeff Baxter tells me what I need to do to fix. If it's a hose, if I can fix it myself. And again, I'm a gentleman. Told me all the parts to get. I saw a local. He sent me over to where a parts store was. I get in a van. I drive over there. It's in the middle of nowhere. There's nothing out there. Where he told me to go, he must not have been local. So I had some transmission fluid that I put in already. I had a quart with me, and I I was about 5 miles away, and I thought, I've got to turn around because it's starting to, you know, shake there. I don't want to be 5 miles from my family and have to walk 5 miles back or run or whatever. So I turn around, about halfway back, I have got to stop and put more transmission fluid. It's just pouring out that fast. Get back to the restaurant. We go get what we need. We end up spending the night. I am failing at this faith thing. I just am. Shannon's like, just get a hotel room. What did you do to fix it home? All right, Pollyanna. But I know what this is, because our lives, I truly live this. Everything is spiritual. And when we face something, we always try to find, what is God trying to show us or let us experience or learn from this? I know exactly what it is, and it hits me. It's testing my faith right now. And I was failing. So during the, everybody goes to bed, and I'm looking, trying to find online a picture of what this line looks like that I'm supposed to fix. And I can't find a picture of anything. If there's a pressure leak or whatever. So I'm laying in bed all night thinking, I hope I don't cut the wrong line. Like if it's leaking somewhere else, what if it's not? And I'm thinking, I can't. So long story, trying to make a long story short, I get up the next morning and I'm walking to the van, want to go fix this. Again, I'm so mechanically challenged, and the way things go with me, it usually doesn't work out. So I'm praying on the way to the van. I said, Lord, just please let me be able to fix this. Because I'm thinking, towing? Expense? No. I'm thinking about if a mechanic fixes it down there, I don't know anything. He can charge me five times. I've never known the difference, you know? So I'm like, Lord, just please let me fix this. I have faith that you can give me the ability to fix this. And for a brief moment, I'm not lying, for a brief moment, I thought, but you can fix it yourself. So I went, jacked up the car, put a little bit of fluid in it to level it off where it's supposed to be. I put it in reverse and, you know, change the gears, keep it in the brake pump, because I don't like that. I can't get it to leak. I'm crawling in, I can't see a leak, I can't see where it was leaking from. I drive around the parking lot, it won't leak. I'm like, really? I drive in, I said, Sam, at the end, you gotta come with me because I need to push it off the road or something. We're gonna test it. So I'm driving all around the city there, pulling into whichever parking lot, checking the fluid. We drove it all the way home, I added just a little bit, probably to make it over the actual line, because we were going to drive further. We were checking it every so often. This morning I got up and looked, it still hasn't leaked all week. We've been driving it, we should be. We're going to have Jeff look at it, because I'm going to share that story with him and let him see that. Because he said, I had never heard of that before. It just stopped me. We got up this morning and still hadn't leaked. Like, praise God. Shandra walks in for rehearsal. She said, Mark, something wrong with the band. I go out there, the level is fine. I start the car up and back it up. I just gotta laugh, guys. I just had to laugh because I'm like, I'm not gonna fail this time. I'm not. God's got it under control. He's got it under control. He did it once. He'll take care of it financially. Whatever's going to happen. But you can't fake faith. You can't do that. Turn over to Matthew chapter 25 and 24. You guys aren't in a hurry, are you? Hope not. Matthew 24, verse 35. Well, at least three people aren't in a hurry, so that's good. Matthew 24, verse 35. Jesus is speaking, and he says, Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them away. Took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Now I want you to understand this. He says, like the days of Noah, so is going to be the coming of the Son of Man. So you think about the days of Noah, and again, this is a whole other sermon to look at. The culture in Noah's time, from what we can gather from the passage that we read, there was some demonic activity going on. There was some sexual immorality and violence that you can't, just let your mind go wild, because we can't probably understand the magnitude of the evil for God to want to destroy the earth, okay? But what I want you to see from this passage that we just read is they were eating and drinking and giving and marrying and so on. One of the problems in Noah's day was they were so evil, they just went about their own day. As Noah built the ark, they just went like business as usual, life as usual. One of the problems was, look at verse 39. It says, and they did not know until the flood came. Noah preached for 120 years. Get ready, repent. Get ready, repent. God's going to flood the earth. He's going to flood the earth. And they didn't know until the flood came. I can't believe that Noah was that bad of a preacher. Noah preached for 120 years and they didn't see it coming. Do you think our culture is a little bit like that? There is a church, there's almost as many churches today as there are Starbucks or McDonald's. There's one almost in every corner. I was thinking about this on the way to church today, and I measured it. In a rectangular area of 1/10 of a mile this way from our church, 4/10 this way, there are 9 churches. 9. I can go out here in on McKinley Street, stand in the middle of McKinley Street and look around and see 6 of them. 6. We have more churches in the United States today than ever before in history, and we're the most evil. What is wrong with that picture? Why is that? Well, one of a couple reasons. One is I believe, and I'm not saying that any of the local churches, I know the pastors around it. I think they preach sound doctrine. But as a whole, as a church as a whole, I think there's churches that water down the gospel. They water down the word. And they try to change a passage that's black and white. Let me just give you an example. I'm just going to make up a Mark Messler Bible verse, okay? Let's say Paul said, don't eat Cheerios. That's pretty simple, right? What's Paul mean? Very good. You guys, and Steve, probably all of you do not have a seminary degree to interpret that passage, right? But in some churches, in some circles, some groups, people take that and say, well, Paul didn't really mean Cheerios. He meant oatmeal. Because if you study the back, you know, this and that, and it could be this, and maybe he means, you know, no, he simply means don't eat Cheerios. Right? I know that sounds absurd, but there are black and white passages that people will take and say, well, Paul didn't really mean that. So either they've watered down what the word says, or people really don't care. And I'm leaning towards that. One example, how much have you heard about Christians being kicked out of Iraq? Not much, probably. How much do you hear about this kind of stuff? People don't care. How about Israel? I pray to God that this country stands with Israel. If not, all bets are off. And you've got to either believe this preacher or you don't. I don't care if you believe it or not. But we're in trouble if we turn our back on Israel. Jesus said, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? Think about what Jesus said is, The way to eternal life is narrow. Narrow is the way that leads to life, right? And few. And broad is the way that leads to destruction. And many will go into that. So he says, Jesus says, well, in Luke 18:8, well, will the Son of Man come to find anything? Think about Noah. No converts. 120 years in Christ. There's coming a time we back up. So Noah builds this ark. And he is shut into the ark. They don't have Noah anymore. Preacher's gone. He's shut up. Every hammer sound that I talked about, every sawing sound, every word preached by this prophet Noah was that used to be a reminder, is silent now. And these people are clueless. One day, I won't be here. One day, the friends that surround you who are preaching to you and trying to get you to come to Christ, they won't be here. And there's going to be a deafening silence because you may be left behind. In Genesis 7:16, it says that God shut the door. Noah didn't. God shut the door to the ark. And in the book of Revelation, it says that when God shuts a door, no man opens it. When God opens the door, no man closes it. So when God closed the door of the ark, even if Noah wanted to let people in at the last second, he couldn't. I believe there's going to come a time when it's over. You can fake faith for a little while, but to most of us in here, but you'll never get by with it with God. I think about Matthew chapter 7. If you want to turn there, you can, but I'm going to go ahead and start reading it. Write it down and look at it later. Matthew 7:21-23 says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. Not that works save you. They don't. But faith without works is dead, right? That's the evidence. See, that's the ark. The ark was the evidence that Noah had faith. But he who does the will of my Father in heaven, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name, and taught Sunday school in your name, and went to church every Sunday that the doors were open? You get the picture, right? And then I declared to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Why? Why? Because they didn't have a genuine faith. They pretended. If the man will come. I want to ask you to examine yourself. Scripture says examine yourself to see if you are in the faith. I want you to really examine yourself right now and ask yourself that if we were in the end time, and I believe we are, we're as close as they've ever been. Do you have a genuine faith? Do you truly trust Christ for your salvation? And is that evidenced by living it out in your life? Will you stand? And as we sing this song, I hope the altar is open. If you want, maybe just come and lay a burden down, pray for something. You have to live your life. Whatever the case may be, maybe you've never accepted Christ's gift of salvation. There's no better time than the day. The scriptures say today is the day of salvation. Examine yourself and ask yourself where you are.
Suffering.
maybe you're, you don't want to come, I know it's kind of embarrassing sometimes, you don't feel worried, that's okay. You say this morning, I just want to maybe rededicate my life. Just in every area of my life. If that's you this morning, just slip your hand up and we'll just pray right now. Anybody else? Lord, we just thank you. So many times, like myself, God, we try to fumble through this faith thing and we fail miserably. And God, I pray right now that you would just be with each person, myself, included, as we lift our hands up to you and just pray, God, that you would guide us, direct us, lead us with our walk with you. Help us as Noah did, his family before him, walk with you. Help us to walk with you. We know we're going to fail at times. Help us to get back up and just dust ourselves off and just to follow you. And many of us have rededicated lives this morning. Pray, God, that you would be with them. Father, those maybe who have never made that decision to follow you, we pray that you would do that. They would give their lives to you. And we just thank you for what you're going to do. It's coming to stand in this.